We're back. It's episode number 43 of the Quinnipiac Athletics Podcast. Joined by sophomore forward on the Quinnipiac women's hockey team, Lexie Adzija. Lexie, what's going on?
Not too much. Just got off the ice of good practice and a big week coming up.
How was practice today? What did we work on?
Lots of transition. I think both teams we're playing this weekend are great transition teams, so a lot of work on that this week.
So you do 5-on-5 or 3-on-3 kind of?
5-on-5, 3-on-3 with shooters, some little back check, a little bit of everything.
I've slowly learned hockey terms.
Really?
Like, I've slowly learned the terminology.
Yeah. When you're around me and you're around some of our roommates, you're kind of forced to.
Yeah.
And like, this is a big hockey school as well.
Yeah.
So like, if you don't, let's kind of learn or die along the way. But
right. And I've learned. I think I've adapted, because if you can't beat them, join them.
So we're doing this live from the lounge, the women's hockey lounge, just after practice. Some of the players are still here. So I kind of want to start, Matt, with some of your team-related questions.
I have team-related questions.
Because we're going to talk about, like, your journey to get to Quinnipiac and everything like that. Yeah. We do that for everyone. But, you know, these are some of the ones that maybe we could get people to chime in on.
Yeah. So the first one is, when you have team meals, who is the best table manners?
Definitely not Zoe Boyd. I would say Kate Riley. She throws a thank you, I'd say, probably every 2 seconds. So.
Really?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. And then the second one was, locker room, either practice or game day, who's on aux?
Alexa Hoskin.
Okay.
She's got some good music.
Wow.
Yeah.
So as a freshman, took over the aux.
Yes. She's pretty confident in her music.
Took
over
the aux.
On the men's side, that is not allowed, I feel like. I feel like on the men's side, not allowed.
We've heard it's been Tufto, and then in the past it was Brogan Rafferty. You know, you really kind of had to earn your stripes there. But hey, what kind of music does she work with?
A little bit of everything. Some pump-up music, some old rock before the game. I think it gets everyone going.
Old rock. Yeah. Foreigner?
Yep, killed. Yeah.
Foreigner. What do we like? We like Jukebox Hero. That's what we like.
Okay, you go on.
The other one is, who's the loudest on the ice, like either chirping and or supporting?
I'd say probably Tabin. She's pretty loud, vocal, a little bit of chirps, and then also a good cheering on her teammates.
All right, that's good.
Yeah.
And then last one was line mate for you. Best line mate for you.
I'd say House and I had a pretty good connection right off the bat, and we've played together. It's the second year in a row, so I think we've got a little connection, and yeah, I definitely love playing with her.
Oh, it was my rapid fire to start it off.
There you go. To kind of continue on trend, so one of the new things this year, if you haven't been to the People's United Center for a game yet, the intro video that they have for you guys, announcing all the players in order by number, has little clips of you guys doing stuff on the ice. So what was the inspiration behind your video clip that goes on the board?
Prater does the, like, it's game day.
Right.
She does the student thing.
Katie Huntington, who's known for the brains, does the science experiment on the camp. So what was the thought behind yours?
I think I just love photo shoots. So
All right.
I'm just going to be honest.
Yeah.
So, I definitely love the camera. So a little runway walk to lighten the mood a little bit before the game.
I think the videos are hilarious.
Grace Markin with the skeleton.
Who do you think had either the best or the most creative one?
Honestly, I love Marquise and Hunts, both little brainiacs there. Marquise with the skeleton, then Hunts with the little potion. I don't really know what's in there, but.
So, Lexia, a long hockey career in Canada before coming to Quinnipiac 2 years ago. So, you know, I want to start off right at the beginning. When did you first get on the ice, start playing hockey?
So, I got on the ice. I think I started skating when I was 3 or 4. And a good little story is, my dad couldn't get me to skate unless he held Smarties at one of the lines for me. So I'd start at the goal line, and unless he had a pack of Smarties there, I wouldn't skate. So if I skated there, I'd open my mouth like a bird, and he'd just drop a Smartie through my cage. So that's how I learned to skate. And just, I guess, took off from there.
I think that may be what youth hockey across all of the U.S. and Canada is missing, a little bit of a reward at the end.
Yes,
for doing
exactly.
That. So grew up in St. Thomas, Ontario.
Yep.
So what's the hockey culture like, not only in St. Thomas, but just Ottawa in general?
So I think St. Thomas is a really small town, and extending into London and that area, I think it's really building right now. So there's a lot more girls playing hockey. But for me, I think my biggest role model is my brother. So seeing him play, and I played my first couple years with the boys and then transitioned to the girls. So I think it's just a community where the hockey community itself is growing a lot. So to be a part of that was really, really good growing up.
Now, was there a big outdoor rink culture in St. Thomas, or was that not quite as big?
Not really. We have one outdoor rink just on the outskirts of my town, but I wish there was. I loved outdoor hockey. I think I did play a lot of pond hockey growing up with my brother.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
So yeah, that was a pretty big thing. And again, just a lot with the boys. And then as I got older, more with the girls. But yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I feel like if you're a hockey person, pond hockey, like, immediately follows. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like you can't. If you play collegiate hockey, you gotta love pond.
Yeah, especially with the cold Canadian winters, so you got a good frozen pond.
Yeah, so right now in St. Thomas, what would be a weather forecast? Like, what are we looking at?
I'd say probably
wind
negative
chill, negative five.
Negative. I was gonna say negative 5 degrees Celsius, maybe a foot of snow, a few snow days.
Oh, Celsius.
Yeah, we tried to do the conversion with Taven on the fly. It did not work, so we're not gonna try.
I think I could do it now. So negative five would be.
Well, zero is freezing.
Zero is 32 degrees for us.
Right.
So just go five below that.
27?
Yeah. 27.
So what were some of the stops along the way? You mentioned playing with the boys for a couple of years, mm-hmm. but what were some of the stops playing in Canada?
I think transitioning to girls hockey. So I had a great team in London for a few years, and then I actually played up in juniors as a grade 9, ninth grader, as you guys would say here. So usually you don't play till 11th grade. So I got a little bit jump start on that. Played 2 years in London, and then I made a transition to Oakville, which was 2 hours from home. So that was definitely a little bit of transition. I went to a boarding school, a private school. So I think for me, I had an amazing coach in Oakville, Brady Cocker, and I learned a ton from her. And then I got double hockey, so I got hockey at my private school, then hockey in Oakville as well. So lots of development for sure there.
What were those first couple of years like in London? Because it mentioned specifically on your bio on the website that you were one of the youngest players in the league, but still third in points in the 2015-16 season. So that's very impressive. But you know, what were some of those lessons as such a young player jumping into that league?
I think just coming into it and as a young player, just being confident. And sometimes that's hard, but I guess I just had to believe in the ability I had, and having some older girls who were great leaders to help me all along the way definitely made a big impact.
So I have a question, and it's more on the serious side, where was there any pressure when you were growing up playing hockey? Because I feel like sometimes in American sports, with youth sports, there's just this pressure that can lead to like serious injuries with people at a young age. Did you find that when you were playing and growing up?
Yeah, I found when I made the jump to play juniors early, there was a little bit of pressure on me coming up. I was the first player, I think, that had done that, at least in my community. So there's a lot of eyes on me, I think.
Okay.
But I took that more as motivation rather than a negative thing.
Yeah.
So one of the more interesting things before coming into college was your time with the U18 national team.
Yes.
So, you know, first of all, what was the process like for you making that team, going through the trials? Like, take us through that.
So the first year I had a little bit of adversity. I got cut the first year and definitely took a little bit of toll on me and took a little bit of time to get some confidence back, but that happens. And then the following year, the coach actually talked to me before the last cuts and said, all right, like, it's between you and four other girls. Like, go show us what you can do this last game. So that's another big pressure moment, I'd say. And
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so I had to really prepare mentally for that last game and that last tryout. And I ended up making the summer series team, so that was another great opportunity for me. And then a little more adversity. I didn't dress my first game in the summer series. So then again, I just took that as motivation, and I came out the second and third game and played really well. And then I got the call that I made the winter team to play in Russia, so that was a big moment for me. And then from there, I got to play on first line with Sarah Filia and Maggie Connors, which was awesome.
Two big names
pretty
in college hockey right now. Yeah.
Yeah, which was awesome to play with them.
Well, three big names in college hockey right now.
Two awesome players. I learned a lot from them. We worked well together. So I think it was a little bit of battle making the team, but I think it was motivation, and it turned out really well. Really great experience.
So you seem to do well under pressure and in pressure moments. Does that also translate to the classroom for you? Like, are you big with tests and like you can nail tests and lab reports?
I think it really depends on the class.
Yeah.
Tends to be the case, yeah.
Yeah. But for the most part, for me, if I know it's going to be a harder test, obviously I prepare more, and it's a little more motivation. If the professor tells us, oh, like the average last semester was, let's say, 70, that gives me a little more motivation to study a little harder and get a good result.
So Matt and I were talking about this in the car ride over to the arena. The experience of playing a tournament in Russia. In Russia.
Yeah.
I mean.
What were those couple weeks like for you? Just, I mean, between the travel and just kind of observing everything going on. You know, take us through that.
Yeah. So there was a lot of preparation leading into the travel just because of the time change. So they actually would have us wake up at 3-4 in the morning and we'd have bright lights that we had to sit in front of. So it's like simulating sunlight because that's the time it would be in Russia, just because that transition does take a toll on you. So getting ready for competition. Long plane ride, really long plane ride.
How many hours, roughly?
I want to say 9-ish.
I would even go. Where'd you leave from?
We left from Calgary and then flew to Toronto. And then, so we had...
Could be even closer to 12.
Yeah.
Wow. Still, long, either long. Way, no matter what, yeah. Because we had a conversation a couple weeks ago with two members of the women's volleyball team who played in... or who are from Greece but played, you know, all around Europe. And they're talking about 24, 25-hour bus rides that they're taking.
Oh, that's
crazy. So you love the flights. But, yeah, so anyways, continue.
Yeah, so definitely a long flight. And then the culture is different. You smile at them, and they're kind of serious.
Yeah.
But that's just how they are. It's not that they're rude people or anything. It's just their culture. That's just how they are. But, yeah, their game. So we actually played Russia in the opening game. Crazy. There was... I want to say 5,000-6,000 fans there.
Had to be.
Wow.
7,999 that were Russian probably. Yeah. And just like loud, like clappers, like crazy. But for me, it was a great experience. I've never played in front of a crowd that big. So to be a women's hockey player and to have an experience when I was 17, turning 18 like that with that many fans was crazy. And then we actually ended up playing them again for the bronze medal game. So again, a crazy atmosphere.
Because if you watch like the 60-minute segments when they go over to Russia and stuff like that, they're into it. Like they're into the sports.
Yeah.
So I'm not even surprised that you said there were like 5,000 people at your game.
Yeah, and then so we actually got to go to a lot of places in Russia, and Moscow was actually really, really beautiful. Crazy, crazy culture. I was lucky my family came down too, so I got to explore with them, which was awesome, a great family experience. But yeah, a different culture, and I think for me, just an amazing experience in general.
So teammates during this time with two fellow future Bobcats. Did you guys know that all three were coming to Quinnipiac at the time?
So... Courtney and Logan, they were committed. Oh, so
make that four.
There's four of us. So yeah, I think that was awesome, especially leading into coming here. We got to kind of develop a bond before coming here, which is pretty cool. And then a lucky addition of Zoe on there. I think that was pretty awesome having four of us part of that team that ended up coming here.
Yeah. So the college experience and coming to college is always one of the most interesting parts that we get to talk about. So, you know, at what point did you start to look at schools and decide, okay, I think I'm ready to continue my career at the Division I level?
So originally I was actually looking at some schools for soccer. And So I made the jump to juniors for hockey, and that's kind of when I decided that I was going to go the hockey route.
Okay.
And Quinnipiac was actually the first school that reached out to me. Cass is the first school that called me. So I was very beginning of my grade 9 year. And I was just like, okay, give me a little bit to adjust here. And then,
right.
And then we'll see how it goes. So I actually was one of the first schools I visited at the end of my grade 9 years when I started touring schools. And I wasn't sure what I wanted. You know, you hear some of the bigger schools like Minnesota, Wisconsin. I went down there. I visited Clarkson, which is a really small school. And then I came here, which is a little bit in the middle, a little bit on the smaller side, but not huge, not too tiny. And I think for me, just the culture here and the atmosphere, how close-knit everyone was a big deciding factor of my decision.
So that word culture, I feel like we hear it every time that we talk to somebody who's part of this program. What is the Quinnipiac women's hockey culture?
So I think we go by pride, collaboration, and success. And then a big thing this year and last year is that we get better faster than any other team. And if you look at the beginning of our season this year, the beginning of our season last year, to our outcome as we progress through the season, I think it's showing already. Like, we had a little bit of a tough start to the season, but we just beat one of the top 10 teams. We tied another top 10 team. So I think that just shows that we do get better faster than any other team.
And I kind of want to swing that into the Nutmeg. You guys were Nutmeg champions in a tournament that was hosted in your own barn. So what was that tournament like, those series of games, because they're closer to each other? And, you know, a tournament is different than just a regular season or a a conference game. So how was that? How do you feel you guys played? Because you took care of Minnesota Duluth, a really, mm-hmm. really good program.
I think it was actually playing off the weekend before. We had a really good weekend the weekend before against SLU. That was a big win. We scored a lot of goals. And then to come and tie Clarkson, who I think is fifth or sixth right now in all NCAA, we had a really good week last week coming off a high. We had a great week of practice. I think as a team, we needed that confidence. We needed that step based on the prior weekend. And then just coming to Minnesota Duluth and just not being afraid, knowing that we could attack them. Yeah, they're a top team, but we just had success against a top team. So I think we had a great week of practice. Everyone, I think, was a big thing was everyone practicing like it was a game. So every practice we came out, everyone was preparing like it was a game. And I think that led to our success on Friday and then playing into Saturday as well.
What's it like to be able to lift a little bit of hardware earlier in the season?
Pretty awesome, actually. One of hopefully more championships this year. But I think, again, just a great moment for our team and a great thing to build off of for the rest of the season.
For sure, especially into conference play, because I've seen it my 4 years here. There's always like a 2-point difference between each team coming down the stretch. So every game counts in this conference.
Yeah, and if you look at our conference right now, there's like crazy things happening. Like Union, we took a hard loss to Union. We lost 1-0 to Cornell, great game there, and then we come out, we tie Clarkson. So I think there's a lot of different things going on, and really any point matters. Like that 1 point against Clarkson can play a big role in where we end in the standings.
Because if you don't think the other teams in the ECAC was like, oh, Quinnipiac just tied Clarkson.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like that is like you're wrong, because every team is watching every game.
Starting back with that 1-0 loss to Cornell, and then overtime loss with an incredible comeback against Harvard, the tie against Clarkson, the win against Minnesota Duluth. The last month or so seems to be coming up all Bobcats. You talked about getting better quickly. Where do you guys think you have gotten better most?
I think just on our transition game. I think that's a big part, especially playing against quick teams like Cornell and Colgate coming up. Clarkson, they're also a big transition team. The quicker we can transition from offense to defense or vice versa, we get the puck in the other zone, catch some of these teams that are more offensive, maybe sleeping a little bit or getting back on the back check. I think that's where our game has really improved, and I think we see it making a really big difference.
So would offensive breakouts fall into that category too of transitions? All right.
Yeah, for sure. A big one just from a turnover, and where do you go? How do you break out of the zone? How do we get more players up in the rush?
All right.
Easier than that.
Makes sense.
So from a personal standpoint, it's been a heck of a start to the season. Last year, 18 points in 36 games, the top returning scorer. This year, already 7 goals, 9 assists, 16 points in 17 games. Matt, that is very good.
Yeah, that is very good. Yeah.
So from a personal standpoint, freshman year until sophomore year, you know, what do you think that you've been able to kind of improve upon, or where have you been able to grow in your game?
I think last year was definitely a transition for me. A little bit homesick, a little bit of transition in terms of the speed of the game and just taking in everything I was learning. I started last year playing wing, something I had to definitely transition to, but I wasn't ready to play center yet. I needed to learn the D zone more. And so I think a big thing for me that I took from last year was just taking pride in the D zone more. And that's where it starts, is from the D zone up. And then another big thing I'd say was focusing more on the process than the outcome. Last year, I would get down when I wasn't getting as many points, or maybe even just when I wasn't performing as well as I could be. So this year I've done a lot of mental skills work. Actually, I'm reading a good book right now called The Champion's Mind. Coach B actually has read it as well, and it's helped me a lot in terms of just focusing more on the process. Like the outcome will come if you focus on the little things. So I think for me, just little things like getting shots, winning puck battles, and I think just wanting the puck in general, whether it's back checking harder, forechecking harder, just taking pride in my D zone.
That's awesome. Cause so how are you reading it? Hardcover or?
Yeah, just reading the book, just a hardcover book.
It's hard to find now. Yeah. That's hard to find now. So that's pretty good. Nice.
Continuing to talk about that growth. Who were some of the players, some of the people in this program that you were able to learn from the most coming in as a first year?
I think some of our seniors last year, we had an incredible leadership group. I think all of them were amazing leaders and amazing teammates. I think two people I really learned from were Randy Marcon and then Melissa Samuskevich. Just seeing the success Samo had last year. It's weird calling her Melissa. But Samo had last year, I think, was really motivating. And just seeing how hard she works in practice, and as well as Randy and all the seniors, and seeing how much they put in to each practice, their preparation, then each game, treating it like it's their last game. And I think that's something they passed along, was that it doesn't really hit you till senior season that every game is one of your last games. Like this, for our seniors this weekend, it's their last games playing Cornell and Colgate in our home rank. So I think for me, just trying to take that senior mentality and put it into every game now as a sophomore.
What's been the value of having Samo back with the program in the volunteer coach position?
I think it's pretty awesome. I think having her as a coaching standpoint as well, she's a great player and she's a great coach. She just gives us little tips in practice and is motivating. And then also her participating in some of the drills, just to see how hard she works and see someone who's had the success she has, it's motivating for everyone in practice. And I think it's definitely up the energy in practice.
So talking about the Cornell Colgate series this weekend, a big day coming up on Saturday, the annual Do It for Darren game. So tell us a little bit about what this game is and what it means to your entire program.
So this game is a big game to raise awareness for mental health, and it's a very unique game to bring the community together and spread positivity and just to tell everyone that, you know, you're not alone and we stick together, and if you're ever going through something, like, we're here and the community will come together to help you.
Pretty good. It's
a special game because I think there is no other programs in college hockey that does something like this. Every time these two teams come together, it's always a nice moment where at the end of the game, you take that picture with both teams, and it's something that isn't done by any other programs across the country, which also adds to the special factor.
Right, right.
Yeah, and I just think that it shows that hockey is more than a game, and it goes beyond the ice, and two teams that are just playing a hard game against each other are able to come together after and spread awareness and support a great cause. Mm.
So before we wrap up, moving along now with the 2019-20 season, what are some of the expectations you have for yourself, and then what are some of the expectations that the team has for the group?
I think for myself, just focusing on the process, I think I've had a lot of success with that so far this season. And rather than focusing on the outcome, I think focusing on the little things. And it's not all about points. It's just how I think I'm playing as an individual and then also as a teammate. I think our team has really great potential this year. I think we've seen it the past few weeks. And even at the beginning of the season, we've been great contenders against some of these top teams. So I think just continuing to get better faster than other teams and preparing for every practice like it's a game will help us have a great end of the season.
Should we ask the questions?
Let's ask the questions.
All right, we asked three questions to all of our guests. Same exact questions every time. These are the thinkers, the real get-to-know-you questions. So the first one, if you could live anywhere in the world that is not Hamden, Connecticut, because we know that's everybody's first pick, where would it be and why?
I'd say somewhere in British Columbia. So my family is a big ski family, so I grew up skiing, and I actually switched to snowboarding, and we took a lot of family trips out there when I was younger. My parents and brothers still go out a few times a year. I think also it's just cool. I see some of the atmospheres they have out there playing like pond hockey with the mountains around you, and I think that'd be pretty awesome.
I've heard so many great things about Vancouver, but just like the kind of more the rural areas too.
So yeah. Escaping to a beach is out the window. You are cold. You're cold.
Yeah, I like the beach as well, but I think winter, just growing up in Canada, that's just...
Yeah, I get it. Nope. I get it, yeah.
Matt's forever team hot over team cold. Yeah, but
I always say it to them all the time. It's like Bahamas immediately.
Yep.
All the time.
Well, see, you can always put on more layers, but you can only take Thank off you. So yes. many layers.
Thank you. You
can I tell, say it every time.
You could tell me that.
Thank you.
You could tell me that until you're blue in the face. People's body language and attitudes change when it's warmer. I'm just saying.
Okay, that's true as well.
I'm just
A little
saying.
Bit of sunlight.
You want to throw on 8 layers? Do it, man. But when I ask you how's your day going, your answers are going to be way better when it's warmer. That's just me, man. That's just me.
All right. Living in a room without air conditioning, I disagree wholeheartedly.
Okay.
Anyway, second question. If you could have dinner with one person, could be alive, deceased, whoever, one person, who would it be and why?
I think I'd choose Haley Wickenizer. Growing up as a female hockey player, I think that's a lot of people's answer. She was an incredible role model. And for me, when I was younger, just watching the Olympics when I was 10 years old, she was a key player along with her and Poulin. And I think looking up, she was both of them actually were two of my really big role models, and just watching what they were able to do, especially growing up playing with the boys for a little bit as well. And yeah.
Matt, so who's been moving higher on your list?
For my
dinner? Yeah, because Justin Timberlake was right
Jonas.
In the top. It was Nick Jonas. That's who it was.
Climbing my list.
Yeah, the Jonas Brothers are coming back.
Oh, show of the year.
Yeah.
I saw them in, oh my God. I saw them in August. Show of the year. Had to have been. Nick Jonas is climbing the list.
Yeah, yeah.
I also wanted to ask about how cool is it to watch women's hockey grow?
It's awesome. I think also the thing that's going on right now with the PWHPA, it's a great movement for women in hockey, and just raising funds so that we can kind of get what we deserve. And we've done a lot of development and just continuing to develop and get some sponsorships.
Yep.
So we can continue to grow the women's game, and so that younger female athletes like myself, when I was younger, can have more role models to look up to.
Because you even watch the WNBA grow. Mm-hmm. Like, if yep. women's hockey can get to that level, and I think it can, that would be something special.
All right, final question. You are on death row, hypothetically, for this one. What is your final meal, your dinner, your drink, and your dessert?
And I will debate you for this for another probably 12 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay, so dinner, growing up, my grandma – do I get like an appetizer?
Yeah. Yeah, sure. Okay. Yeah, so, full, we can go full three course.
Because so if you ask mine, mine's got an appetizer too.
Yeah.
So my grandma, she makes this like awesome Croatian stew that's kind of like an appetizer.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'd say that is the appetizer. And then lately, I've had a really big thing for burgers. Okay. Like I could have a burger.
Before you tell me what's on the burger, what's in the stew?
So,
because you said Croatian, so is
yeah,
it?
Yeah, well, she just has her own garden, so she throws all her like veggies and stuff in there. I think a little bit of salt. It's all just healthy. It's like,
is there a protein or no? There's
oh
no,
yeah,
like, beef or
you get some
it?
Chicken in there.
Oh, it is chicken.
Yeah, right. A little bit of chicken. Sometimes beef. She wants to switch it up, but usually some chicken, yeah. Fresh, a lot of fresh vegetables. Yeah, my brother was never a fan. Very, very picky. Very picky. Yeah. But
actually, before you continue with the burger, where's the last name Adzija from?
Croatia.
It is Croatia. Croatia.
Yeah.
Okay, right. And I have to ask this because as a broadcaster for this team, I had a bear of a time remembering Adzija. What are some of the pronunciations that you've heard for your last name over playing hockey?
Like first grade, elementary school, we're going through attendance. What yeah. have you gotten?
Adzija. Yep. Adzija.
Okay.
Is there an X? Like, does someone pronounce the X? Like, it's yeah. a Z. All right, the Z.
Does no, they do not pronounce the X.
Yeah, there's no X.
I say, well, what
like the Z, like the like. I feel like if someone goes heavy on the Z, yeah. it's wrong.
Yeah. No, there's a lot of silent letters in there. I've had a little bit of everything. Sometimes I just got Lexi A.
Yeah.
We're not
yeah.
even gonna try. Yeah. Lexi A. That's
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I'm trying to. I can't remember for the life of me what I thought it was the first couple games.
Adzija,
that may be it.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Oh God.
Lots of silent letters in there.
Yeah. I had to ask because it's always been so funny. And then you hear other after learning more about the team, you hear other people coming in and being like, yeah, Lexie Adzija, and I'm like, no, that's
no.
not
yeah,
it.
No,
that's just not it.
Because they come in all confident, and you're like, dude.
Yep. Yep. Anyways, but okay, so we start with the Croatian stew, but then you've been on a burger kick recently, which
yeah.
is a great kick
great
to be
pick.
On.
Unbelievable
yes.
pick.
Yes.
So what are we throwing on it?
So I had this burger. Have you guys gone to Prime 16? It's in New Haven?
Yes,
no.
Prime 16.
You have.
A
great,
yeah. That's
a food guy. I haven't.
Good spot.
A great burger place.
Yes.
Great burger place. I had some onions, mushrooms on there, pickles, sauce. I don't know. I like to mix up the sauce. Sometimes
okay.
a little bit of barbecue.
I am a massive sauce guy. And if you're, yeah, you got to go barbecue
yeah.
if you're doing mushrooms.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think that's my go-to. I have to have some dill pickles on there or I won't eat the burger.
Fantastic
pick.
Fantastic
pick. Yeah. Won't bite you on that.
I think cheese, mozzarella cheese maybe, cheddar sometimes. You know, it depends on the mood.
I do cheddar and provolone on mine.
Oh,
yep.
There you go.
Yeah, that's
yeah,
good.
Yep.
Aside to my burger. So again, my grandma, she makes really good mashed potatoes.
Okay, yeah.
So that or...
a good mashed potato remains undefeated. Just coming off of the Thanksgiving holiday, a
yeah.
good mashed potato, oh my God.
I'm sweet potato fries. Sweet potato fries get me sometimes too.
So what we do at my Thanksgiving is you do sweet potato with pecans,
oh.
but you also include cinnamon with it. It's out of
delicious.
This world.
That's pretty good.
Out of this world.
And sweet potato fries, yeah, as long as they're crispy.
Yep.
Yeah,
yes.
you really can't go wrong. Okay, all right. So we have the Croatian stew, we have the burger, we have the either the mashed potatoes or the sweet potato fries, or we're on death row, so it could be both.
Yeah.
Drink and dessert.
Drink Propel.
Really?
What flavor?
Specific flavor?
What
yeah.
flavor?
Yeah.
What flavor? This is a wild pick. So what flavor? What flavor?
I'd say berry or the strawberry lemonade.
Okay, if you said grape, I would have walked away.
I do like grape too. Yeah.
Oh man, I would rather do the strawberry lemonade, the one you said, or
yeah. Any kind of berry.
Berry is good.
Okay. Dessert.
Ice cream. Any type.
Any type.
Actually, not a big chocolate girl. Moose Tracks, love. Do you guys know what Moose Tracks?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Moose Tracks.
Yeah.
I like vanilla, peanut butter, Reese's, anything like that.
Yep.
Vanilla base with some stuff
in there. Okay, yeah. So not like the chocolate flavor, but there can be chocolate all in there.
Just the vanilla base.
It has to be vanilla base. And then, peanut butter, fudge swirl, pretzels. Yeah. Anything.
Throw it in there.
Not bad. I'm hungry. Matt, are you hungry?
Yeah, I'm starving.
Matt McAuliffe with his granola bar lunch. Yeah, we're going to go fix that.
Granola bar lunch was the worst decision.
We're now on a two podcast cold streak. Nobody's picked cheesecake the last two podcasts.
Oh, cheesecake is good. Cheesecake ice cream. Have you ever had that?
Lexi, we had
four
guests in a row say cheesecake.
I was living my best life because cheesecake is the correct answer.
It was. I could not believe how many people said that dessert. Well, I would do like lava cake, cookies, anything like cheesecake.
Really?
Yeah, well, you're a big chocolate guy. Like that's what I've learned from these answers. Yeah. Like the lava cake, the chocolate, like they all have chocolate mixed in somewhere.
Skillet cookie all day. Yeah. All day.
That's a good choice too.
You really can't go wrong. No. Either way with the dessert
and
part.
Then how do you like your burger? Medium?
Medium.
Yeah. Me too.
Not too red, not just like perfect medium.
Yeah, because sometimes, like, if I'm not at, like, a, like, Michael Jordan steakhouse, saying medium rare is, like maybe they'll get it right.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I personally would rather a little bit more done than not.
Okay.
I'm on your side with that. Yeah, like, it's not going to be too tough if you say, like, a medium or even medium well, but if you go, if it's less.
Yeah, sometimes you can be a little rocky.
You got to have the taste for that. Yeah. Well, Lexi, a big weekend coming up here to close out the first semester against Cornell Colgate. Best of luck moving forward.
Thank you for joining us. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, absolutely.